The Technique Series is brought to you by Barbell Logic Online Coaching. Did you know that you can get a 100% free form check from one of our expert strength coaches? Seriously, absolutely 100% free. No credit card needed, no questions asked. Just go to barbelllogic.com/technique and sign up for the free Barbell Logic experience now. Do that right now and then enjoy the show.
Welcome to Barbell Logic Rewind.
This is the Barbell Logic Podcast. I'm Scott Hambrick, and I've got Matt Reynolds with me, as we always do. And we're at the Baymont Inn and Suites in Wichita Falls yet again. And Matt just poured a drink for us. But today is going to be about the bench press. We're going through all the big four lifts.
Are we talking about the bench press?
Yeah, we're talking about the bench press.
I thought we were talking about cues.
We're going to talk about cues in a little while. We've got three shows to do. Let's talk about the whistle. Let's get a hand in. Wait a minute. What's this say?
Well, you didn't tell me.
What's it?
This is the bench press.
All right.
Episode 63.
So we talked about the squat. We've talked about the press.
Yep.
And today we're going to talk about the bench press, the other pressing motion. Deceptively simple.
It is. You know what's interesting about the bench press is that I would say the vast majority of clients who sign up for online coaching, they all do a test workout, right? All of them do. Mm-hmm. And the majority of them do their bench press within 90% of correct on the first day.
Well, wait a minute. Okay. All right.
But that last 10%.
That last 10%
is really hard, right?
That's where the gravy is.
Yeah, it is. And so, I mean, probably a lot of that is because of just there's been some neural efficiency, like motor pattern developed there for a lot of people, because a lot of people have bench pressed more than they've done anything else, right? So
people
they bench press in high school, they bench press in college. And so let's walk through the big pieces.
So,
and let's save the 10% that they're going to screw up for the second part of this podcast.
Right. So you lay down on the bench.
You lay down on the bench. The first part is you got to get tight on the bench. So how do we get tight on the bench?
Well, is that the first part?
Or is it where you set your eyes?
Well, I have the lifter lay down on the bench. I have him roll the bar out to the front of the hooks.
Okay. So stop. We actually haven't talked about that. So for those of you who lifted before, this is common. But if you haven't, this is actually something you should be doing on all of your lifts, right? Would you agree on the squat?
Roll the bar to the front on all the lifts?
I do. Do you not?
No.
Okay. I do on all.
No, I take the bar out of the back of the hooks on the press and the squat.
Well, it's so screwed up. I don't think we can be friends anymore.
I have to push into the bar so hard to get it down low on my back. I can't pull it out of the front.
Okay, so on the squat, I totally get it, right? So on the bench press, for sure, you should be rolling the bar forward.
Right.
To the front of the J hooks.
That's right. And we roll it forward because if we take it out of the hooks from the back, we're more likely to hit the bottom of the hook when we're
on the way back up.
When we're on the way back up.
That's exactly right.
So I have them roll the bar to the front of the hooks. If it's a lady, I have them measure from the inside knurl with their thumb, and that's their starting grip for most ladies. And then most men, I'll have them put their pinky or maybe even their ring finger on the first ring.
Okay.
And then that's where we start. Have them take it out, lock their elbows, take it out of the hooks.
Hold on. I'm going to back up. So we established where the bar goes in the rack first.
That's right.
The next step is we have to establish where we line up with the barbell.
Oh, that's true.
So where do you line up with the bar?
I'm sorry. Yeah. So we have the lifter almost every time we scoot them 4 inches down the bench.
Forward.
Towards their rump, right? Yeah. They move off the end of the bench such that when they look at the ceiling, their eyes are on the same side of the bar as their hips.
Yeah, it's just below. Your eyes are going to be just below the barbell. Is below the right word?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's
So we press out of a rack often, right?
Yeah, out of a squat
rack. We're off the front of a squat rack, and so you're going to move down the bench away from the squat rack,
yeah.
So your eyes won't be on the rack side of the bar.
Sure.
They'll be on the outside
far side
of the bar.
Yeah. The eyes are mostly going to be underneath the bar.
Yeah,
but they're going to be a little bit to the far side of that. So,
and again, the reason for that is the same reason we take the bar out of the front of the hooks. It's to make sure that when the going gets tough, our bar path is going to be free of the hooks. We're not going to hit the hooks on the way up.
Okay. So now before you go to the grip, then let's talk about getting tight on the bench, because really before you go to the grip, I want to get tight on the bench, right?
man, I just can't get tight unless I got the thing, like my shoulders pinned back by the weight.
What are you going to do with an empty barbell?
Not much.
Well, I mean, you can still facilitate. This is what we're going to try to do. So let's talk about what you're going to try to do. So you're going to try to...
You're going to try to like pinch a dime between your shoulder blades.
Yeah, your shoulder blades are going to be fully retracted. They're going to be kind of pulled together. You're going to get as much of your posterior delts on the bench as possible.
Yeah, right. If our shoulders are in, shoulder blades are in protraction.
Yep. They've spread apart.
Spread apart. Your shoulders are up off the bench. We've got more range of motion than we need. And the surface area of your back that's in contact with the bench is not very much.
Correct.
If you pull those shoulder blades back together, there's probably 10 times the surface. I mean, literally like 10x sure. surface area laying on the bench. So you're a lot more stable. Takes a lot of the left to right wiggle motion out of the thing.
Sure.
Reduces the range of motion. Then you pull your chest up as high as you can. Have a little bit of arch in your lower back. A little. We don't bridge a lot. And
so some arch, right? So you said it. I want to make sure. So there's going to be some air. There's going to be some space underneath the low back.
You bet. There needs to be
space underneath there.
I need to be able to put my hand under there, but I don't need to be able to put my fist under there.
Yeah. And some of that depends on how skinny you are and how mobile you are or whatever. So, and then your feet, for most of us, now we may disagree a little bit on this. I don't know that you and I do, but some people, I like my feet flat on the floor.
I do too.
But walked back as far kind of underneath my body as I can get them while still being flat on the floor. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I agree with that.
So I don't want my feet way out in front of my body. I want them nice because what that does when I walk them back, I feel some tightness in my hip flexors on the front of my hips. It creates the lower
half.
Which I
get a Charlie horse, by the way.
Yeah, right. That's where your hips will cramp. It creates the lower half, the inferior side of the arch on the bench press. So you've got the kind of superior side and you've got the inferior side. And so we get just as tight as we can on the bench press. We get everything tight, right? In the same way in a squat or deadlift or press, we make everything tight because when it's not tight, it's an energy leak. It can also be an energy leak on the bench press. So I just want to get as tight as I possibly can. Now, take us to the grip.
So like I said earlier, the ladies, you know, typically I have them measure from the inside knurl one thumb's length out, a little wider grip, right? Or sorry, a little narrower grip than the men. Unlike on the press, the men and the women take a pretty much the same grip on the press.
Sure.
It's not very much difference. And then men, I'll have them either put, depending on how broad shouldered they are, either their pinky or their ring finger on the inside ring on their power bar.
Okay.
And that's where we start.
Yep.
And then we really don't know, right, until we take it out of the rack and they touch their chest and then we can kind of figure out where it needs to be.
Right. So I would agree.
Dial it in. Exactly.
So women, what they're going to end up, if everybody in the press, since we did the press in a previous episode, takes a grip, basically they put their hands where the knurl starts. Females are going to tend to take a grip about a half a hand width wider than their press grip. Hand width.
Yep.
And guys are going to take like a full hand width or even a full hand width and an extra finger wider than their press grip. Right. Yeah. Now, obviously, again, that's just a starting point. We don't know that that's where they're going to be. We've got things that we can do as they start to bench press that tells us whether we're right or wrong. So they get ready to go.
Yep. And so remember, we put our shoulder blades in retraction. We put our chest way up and we've taken this grip that we've already described. And all of those things should help us have optimal mechanics. You know, that angle of attachment with the pec and the humerus, that's going to be about as good as we can get.
Yep.
Right. And then we're going to have them lock their elbows out and then swing it out over their shoulder joint.
Right. So the balance point in all of the lifts where we stand up is the middle of our foot. But on the bench press, we're not standing up.
Right.
So it's not the middle of our foot.
I'd like to see him try it.
That's right. It's the glenohumeral joint. It's your shoulder joint, right? That's the fancy term for it's essentially where that the head of the humerus goes into the glenoid fossa. Is that right? The glenoid fossa. And so
Nick approves.
Yeah, Nick Solin's over here drinking our whiskey and shaking his head yes. So that's the balance point, right?
That's right.
So at the top of when you first get take the bar out of the rack, that's where it is in balance. That's where it starts and that's where it finishes.
That's right. So a lot of people, particularly older people, they want to put that thing over their eyes.
Yep.
That's not where it goes. In the beginning, it's going to feel like it's too far forward. It's going to feel like it's too far over your tummy or something. But no, it's over the shoulder joint. Your coach is going to put it where it needs to be.
Yep.
If you don't have a coach, you should get one. Now, you're going to look up at the ceiling. You're going to take a mental picture of where that bar is in relationship to the ceiling. So you pick a landmark on the ceiling, you know, a light fixture or a whatever.
Ceiling tile.
Yeah, we have a pro wrestling poster on the ceiling above our bench.
From like the early 90s.
Yeah, from the 90s. It's tacky as hell. Stephen Gunn gave it to us. And so you can see where the bar is in relation to the Ultimate Warrior up there. And then you're just going to go down, touch the bar at about your nipples, maybe just a little bit lower. And then press it right back up into that same position on the ceiling. Now, when it touches your chest, and you're going to barely touch your chest, like there was a pane of glass on your chest, and you didn't want to break it. You're going to just touch. And when you touch, your forearm should be perpendicular to the ground.
And totally vertical.
In both planes.
Sagittal. Just about.
Yep.
Although I'll explain the nuanced piece of that. No?
No. And then you press it out.
Yeah.
Press it right back out. And we're going to do it 5 times, then we rack it.
Okay, so... that is how you press bench press within 90% of correct. Now right. Let's talk about the little tweaks. All right. So if I take the bar out of the rack.
Yeah. Yeah. So you say get it 90% right. I don't think it can get 100% right till it's close to your body weight.
Well, that's fine on the weight. I'm still talking about form. So okay. I'm just talking about form. So if you take the bar out of the rack, it's a balance over the shoulder joint, glenohumeral joint. As we break at the elbows and shoulder, we can't let the bar come straight down over the glenohumeral joint. Right now, everything that we know about physics says that a barbell moved in its most efficient manner is moved in a straight vertical line because gravity pulls straight down and I want to work against gravity. Anything that I'm not doing that's not vertical is not working against gravity.
If you keep it completely vertical bar path here on this bench press, you're going to tear some stuff up.
Yeah, you will grind the head of your humerus and your AC joint. The same thing that you'll do if you stick your elbows straight out to the sides on a press, it's the same thing. You impinge the shoulder, the soft tissue of the shoulder. It's really what it is. It's the tendons of the rotator cuff getting pinched there between the head of the humerus, which is the top of your upper arm, for those of you guys who don't know what the humerus is, and that bony bump, that bony protrusion on your shoulder. You can feel that. It's your AC. And so we can't do that. So in order to clear that, those of you guys who are watching on video, if you're listening to us now and you take your arms and you put your elbows out so that your forearms are at a 90-degree angle perpendicular to your torso, you can actually feel that pinch at the top of your shoulder. And if I just drop my elbows down about 15, 20 degrees, we don't know exactly where that is. It depends on anthropometry. It clears that, and now it's fine. Now, if I drop my elbow, if I tuck my elbows 15 to 20 degrees, that's going to make the touch point of the barbell no longer directly in line with my shoulders, but down closer towards the bottom of my breastbone. Now, here's the problem. We can't really use an anthropometric point to say where we touch, right? Because I can't say touch the bottom of your sternum or an inch above your sternum, because we've all seen the guy that's got a sternum that's 12 inches long and it goes halfway down his belly. He can't touch there, but you get the general idea, right?
The bigger the chest is, like the closer that they can put it in to the shoulder.
Of course, right? The more you can roll your nipples and line your nipples up, put your nipples above your shoulders, so that when you lay on the bench press, you kind of roll your shoulders under your nipples, or you put your nipples above your shoulders, and so it rotates, the more you're able to do that, the closer you get that touch point in line with the shoulder joint, so that you take out some of those inefficiencies of the bar path, and the bar still mostly moves vertical, right? Yep. So the bench press, no matter what, no matter how perfect you do it, is the only lift we teach that is not going to have a perfectly vertical bar path. The power clean is not going to have a perfectly vertical bar path either. We don't talk a lot about a power clean, but if you do a bench press exactly right, it's still not going to have a perfectly vertical bar path. The bigger chest you are and the more you can arch, the more vertical bar path you'll have while still being able to tuck those elbows and that humerus at a 15, 20 degree, 25 degree angle somewhere in there, and you'll clear the shoulder. The shoulder stays clean. Everything is healthy. Beautiful, and you get a nice, tight, clean, mostly vertical bar path. I hope you're enjoying this episode in the technique series of the Barbell Logic podcast. You know, at Barbell Logic, we believe that barbell-based strength training is literally for everyone, and that the only thing holding most people back from all the incredible benefits that come from it is good technique and consistency, and we can help with that too. And whether you're just getting started or you've been lifting for a while, it's difficult to know if you're performing the lifts correctly or if there's anything you can do to make your lifting better. We have tons of free resources online, from basic how-to videos that'll get you lifting safely and efficiently right away, to podcasts, articles, and videos that will help you troubleshoot common errors. All you have to do is visit barbelllogic.com/technique to see our best technique-focused content in one place. And while you're at it, you can sign up for a consultation with a Barbell Logic coach. This is a free form check and a chance to ask an expert all your training-related questions. There's no reason you should be struggling to get started or to make progress. Check out barbelllogic.com/technique for more information and sign up for the Barbell Logic experience. Again, it's 100% free. There's nothing better for your training than knowing you're lifting safely, training efficiently, and on the right track. All right, let's get back to the show.
You know, we have our rules that we use to pick our lifts, right? Most muscle mass, longest effective range of motion.
Correct.
So we pull our chest up. We get a little bit of arch in our back. One, I think, so you may correct me here. One, so that we get this optimum bar path if we can. And two, mm-hmm. so that we can push more efficiently,
yep.
right? So they get the chest up more. If we can optimize the angle of attack that the pec pulls on our humerus with,
sure.
then we'll get a better press. But we're not really trying to shorten the range of motion. So we're not taking a
correct.
Super wide grip on the bar. We're not bridging more than we need to for good mechanics.
Correct.
We're not artificially shortening the range
right,
of motion.
Which a power lifter would do, and it's okay, right? Yep. So again, we've talked about this before.
Yep.
A power lifter that's competitive is going to get rid of that greatest effective range of motion criteria. We're trying to get people generally strong. Therefore, we use the greatest effective range of motion. A power lifter is going to move the bar the least legal range of motion.
Yep.
Well, the least legal range of motion for a bench press means it has to start with the elbows locked out. It has to touch the chest. It has to pause, actually, on the chest.
Right.
And it has to finish locked out with the elbows locked out again. And so I can take as wide of a grip as they'll let me, which actually the widest grip that they'll let you is that the rings have to be covered. So that means your index fingers have to be on the rings. That's
right.
Really wide, by the way. It's really wide.
Right.
Nice big giant arch. You know, I get a big arch. And I can touch lower on my belly. We can talk about that, why that is. And I can throw it back as much as I can. And I can basically turn it into a little more of a circus lift.
No.
Well, I mean, it's
I get it.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
We'd have our guys and ladies train with our very strict long range of motion bench press. And then we'd have them practice the wide grip press.
That's
and
exactly
get ready,
right.
Get
so
ready
there's
for
the difference
their
between the competition version of this
yep.
lift and just the normal, I'm trying to get generally strong version of this lift. By the way, it's the same thing with the press. We talked about the press, last week, 2 weeks ago, whatever. So the Olympic style press, if I'm going to throw the press as hard as I can and then put a bunch of layback in, is that the kind of press that's going to get me generally the strongest?
No.
So for people who do an Olympic style press, who are competitive pressers, who press at, you know, strength lifting meets, I would absolutely argue that there needs to be some strict pressing in their training. They need to be standing strict pressing, maybe seated strict pressing, maybe low pin press, press lockout sort of pressing that where there just isn't any of that momentum
right.
in order to build the strength and a full range of motion. And so bench press is the same.
So here in a moment, I want to talk about the advantages we get from lowering that touch point.
Yep.
I want to talk about leg drive and maybe also some supplements to bench press.
Okay. But,
so you mentioned moving that touch point down. So let's hear about that.
Okay. So let's talk about the touch point. Let's talk about the bar path. So there's something that we notice with powerlifters that the bar path for most powerlifters bench press is far less vertical than what we teach.
Yep.
There is an enormous amount of horizontal movement on the bench press. And I'll start by saying this is absolutely theory, and I'm not entirely sure why that is. I've thought about it a lot. I've drawn stuff out. There are a couple things that occur. One, for years, powerlifters used bench shirts.
Yeah.
Right? And the bench shirt loaded. So a bench shirt, if you don't know what a bench shirt is, think of a straight jacket, like you were in a crazy house, and it holds your arms like straight forward. As if you've locked out the bench press.
Right.
And usually be made out of denim or canvas or really tight polyester. And as you lower the bar, the chest plate of this shirt, the chest, it doesn't really stretch. It's just, it doesn't have any stretch to it. And so it would load a lot of energy in it as you lowered the bar. Well, it was easier to touch lower and load that chest plate the way the cut of the shirt was.
I'm not buying that.
Really?
Well, I mean, I'm sure that's true. But if I move the touch point down, I can throw more in a t-shirt.
Okay, no, that's fine. But so these were the first guys, though. It didn't happen that much. Like, the touch point changed a lot out of the bench press shirt years of the 90s and early 2000s. And then we started to see the raw lifters did the same thing.
Right.
And so the shirt comes off, and you think, well, we got to touch high. And then these guys start to experiment with this, like, low touch point. Mm-hmm. They still touch low, and they still bench press more.
Yep.
Now, the question is why?
I think the leg drive is more efficient.
Okay, so I think a couple things occur.
So if you get this arch, and then you kick, the more perpendicular, you know, there's an asymptote, right, that touches that arch.
Sure.
The more perpendicular to the bar path that you want that asymptote is, the more efficient the leg drive will be.
Okay, so I think there's actually some muscular physiological reasons as well. I actually think that the front delts are able to contribute to the bench press more.
Nope. Yeah, I agree with that.
For sure, right? So if you tuck your elbows about the same amount on this, like, kind of low touch point, and then maybe tuck just a little bit more, right? The pecs are still getting stretched a lot.
Yep.
They might not contribute quite as much as they did, but they contribute quite a bit. Two other things do occur, though. As you tuck your elbows more, especially if you're a big muscular person with a great big giant back of big lats, big triceps, you actually get this compressive effect of the triceps pressing against the lats as you lower the bar, and the front delts get stretched in a way that they didn't get stretched with the higher touch point. So now the front delts and pecs can contribute to the throw off the chest from a muscular standpoint more than they would with a higher touch point. Also, I can touch the bar low. I can use, you mentioned leg drive, so we haven't talked about leg drive. So leg drive is interesting because the bar, this kinetic chain of the movement, goes through the arms, into the shoulder joint, and into the bench. It really shouldn't have anything to do with the body below the shoulders.
That's what the kinetic chain is until the instant the bar touches your chest, and then the kinetic chain is different.
It goes from there. Yeah, you're exactly right. Now, but here's the thing. Even when the bar touches low on your chest, would you consider the legs part of the kinetic chain?
At that point, it is.
But in general, most people don't.
Right.
But it is.
It
contributes. What are the legs? What are you doing with your legs when you throw the bar off your chest?
So remember, we said we'd like to wear our squat shoes when we bench press. And it's because we have that big flat sole. It's like a racing slick, maximum surface area contacting the ground. So we've got our feet flat on the ground. Some people don't, but that's the way Reynolds and I like to do it. And I learned it from him. So of course I like it. And then we want to apply a shear force to the ground. It's like you're going to scoot your feet away. Of course, you don't let them slide.
Right.
And you do that to push your knees back towards your shoulders.
Yeah, ends up driving your traps and your rhomboids and your rear delts into the bench more. So it drives them down and back into the bench. And what it will often do is then you'll get some energy transfer off of the chest where the bar is sitting, where the bar is touching, right? So if the chest moves a little, a little chest bump.
That's what we want.
In powerlifting, a big chest bump is illegal, and I'm not talking about a bounce. This is not a bounce. You lower the bar, you touch a little bit lower, you pause on the chest. There's just a little bit of sink, whether you want there to be or not, and then wham, you fire the muscles of your legs, you drive your heels into the floor, you push your heels away from your body. That drives your traps into the bench and makes your chest come up a little bit. And you get about like a half inch, maybe even an inch, of kind of a chest bump.
Yep. So if your body is making an arch where the ends of the arch that are rooted is your rump and your shoulders, and then you shove with your legs, you can essentially move the ends of that arch closer together.
Correct.
And if you move the ends of that arch closer together, the top of the arch
gets
higher.
Exactly right. Just like a longbow, just like the longbow we talked about in a press. It's actually the same thing, right? So we're just creating a longbow with our body on the bench that lifts the chest. When the chest lifts, there's a kind of dynamic explosion there, and the bar comes flying off your chest. Now, here's the other thing. Most of those powerlifters don't lock the barbell out directly above their shoulder joint.
I'm not ready to talk about that yet.
Okay.
I have one more thing to say about that leg drive. you taught me that leg drive very, very well. And I can now press more paused than I can without the pause.
I can too.
And I think if you've got that leg drive down, I think that's going to be universal. If you learn the leg drive, you can bench more paused than you can without it.
Yeah, I think so too.
But, you know, early on, we all get a little bump off of that sternum, and you get a little explosion there, and you kind of rely on that. But I'm telling you, if you can get tight, stay tight, bring that bar down, bend it in your hands, build that tension, pause, and then kick it off your chest.
Yeah.
It's worth 15 pounds at least.
I would agree. So then you kick it off the chest. and it locks out, and you think to yourself, why did that lock out superior or north of or right. above the shoulder joint a little bit?
Mm-hmm. Lock it out over your eyes.
Yeah, you don't actually lock it out over your eyes. So that's no, I mean, that's a cue
right.
that I'll give somebody. That's one of those overcorrective cues, right? So what actually happens is it ends up locking it out just a little bit superior to the shoulder joint. Right. Now, the question is why?
Yeah. Does anybody really know? We're fitting to speculate. Yeah,
I'm going
to
speculate. So I'm just going to speculate.
Here's my thought. So get on your chest, pec, triceps, lockout.
Okay.
So I've got two muscle groups really there doing most of the work, a little delt, like you said. But if I can lock it out north of that, there's a point where I can use the flexors of the, is that right? Yeah, this is the flexors of the shoulder.
Is that right? Extensors.
Yeah, this is shoulder extension.
Yeah, that's flexion. Right. Okay, good. Yep.
The flexors of the shoulder to help get that bar.
No, I understand what you're saying.
So,
sure.
And so it's two things. My range of motion is lesser if I move the thing back over my head.
Okay, hold on. Your range of motion isn't, but the amount of work you have to do against gravity is
that's
less.
Right. That's
which
right.
are two different things. Now think
right.
about this.
You're right.
If I touch the bar directly over my shoulder joint, which I've explained already will cause problems, right?
You simply can't do
you can't
it, actually.
Do it, right? You're going to impinge. But let's say you do, or let's say you get it really close to your shoulder joint, and then you lock it out directly over your shoulder joint. That's actually the least range of motion that you can do
against gravity.
Touching against gravity, right? But what we're talking about is touching lower down at the bottom of the breastbone or even the top of the belly, and then locking it out superior to north of the shoulder joint.
Yep.
Now, that's a much longer range of motion in general.
Less work done against gravity.
But
though.
It's less work done against gravity. Now, why is it less work done against gravity?
Well, because we change all the moment arms, and the ultimate travel from the bottom of the rep to the top of the rep is lesser.
Correct.
Now, it travels more distance laterally.
Sure.
But in vertical distance is decreased that way.
Sure.
And so if I can decrease that amount of work done and recruit the flexors of the shoulder as I get up over that joint, I could add a little muscle mass to it and I can lock the thing out.
Yep.
And because we can move the thing, we can float it back towards our face and we can actually extend our elbow as we do that without doing work against gravity.
That's right.
And so you can get past that hard point.
That's right.
Without actually working against gravity.
This is super important. Everybody understands. Now listen, what he said was, I can actually make my elbows continue to extend as I take the bar from low over the chest to high over the neck. The elbows will extend. Just you can try it right here. The elbows are super, super bent with the bar over my chest. And the elbows are much more straight with the bar over my neck. And the bar didn't go up any. It didn't travel above. So here's how we figured this out. When I started playing with this is...
You guys have to understand how big a deal this is.
It's a big deal.
It's a big,
Nobody's ever
deal.
Talked about that. Okay, so one of our favorite supplemental lists for the press is a press lockout, right? We put the press at like eye height or forehead height or above the head a little bit or whatever, and we press it straight up. Well, powerlifters, I learned from back in the old days of Westside and that sort of stuff when I did competitive powerlifting type stuff, one of the accessory movements or supplemental movements we did was the same thing for the bench press. So you lay in the bench press, you put the bar on the pins, and you would press straight up and you would lock it out. And you know, there'd be 4, 5, 6 inches range of motion. And so what I would do is I would roll the bar down directly over, say, my nipple line, and I would load the bar up with, I don't know, 10% more, 15% more than I could actually bench press.
Over your one rep.
Right. Oh, yeah, above my one rep max. Mm-hmm. So let's say I one rep max 405. I've got 435 on the bar, 440, something like that. And I put it over my chest, and I press, and doesn't move. By the way, nothing hurts worse, bicep tendonitis, forearms, all that sort of stuff, than when that thing doesn't move off the pins. And I couldn't figure out why. And so I was like, man, I know I can I lock this much weight. And I started to roll the bar up the pins closer to my chin.
That's funny.
And boom, it locks out. I'm like, why does it do that? And so I did it over the shoulder joint. Boom, locked out a lot easier. Roll it a little north of the shoulder joint. Boom, locks out even easier. Well, what you start to notice is as you roll that bar, so you don't change the pin height, right? So let's say the pins are 8 inches above your chest. 10 inches above your chest, whatever. The more I roll the bar closer to my face, I roll it superior to my body, and I lock it out, the bar moves less.
Yep.
So when it's over my mouth, that lockout's only an inch and a half. But when it's over my shoulders, it's a 3-inch lockout,
yep.
right? And when it's over my chest, there's too much moment arm to overcome. There's a moment arm between. At that point, in a regular bench press, the bar should have already floated up over the shoulder. So I was trying to put it over the spot originally where I would touch at the chest.
Yeah, that's too far.
Well, that doesn't make
out.
Any sense, right? It's so there's too much of a moment arm to overcome. So what we found, we believe, is that for those people who are competitive bench pressers, competitive, we can touch a little lower. We can take a little wider grip. We can get a little bigger arch. We can touch a little lower on the chest. And we can throw it back. What we say is we say throw it back over the face. I don't know that you're actually throwing it back over your face.
I tell them to push it back toward the rack.
Yeah, toward your eyes or whatever. And so, again, it's probably an overcorrective cue. What they're probably doing is locking it out over their chin, over their throat, somewhere in that ballpark. And the bar moves a little less against gravity. And what you do is you lock out the elbows, and then you've got a moment arm there between where the bar is and your shoulder joint. But after the elbow locks, I can just move the bar back over the shoulder joint, settle back in, get the rack command if I'm in bench pressing in a powerlifting meet, rack it, and I'm good to go.
Yeah, your lats are plenty strong to do that.
Yeah, so the way to test this is with a spotter.
Yep.
And the next time you start to bench press and you start to really grind on a rep, and a rep really slows down 6 inches, 7 inches, 8 inches off your chest, and you can't get it, just start floating it back over your face. Make sure you got a good spotter, right? Make sure you got your pins in the rack so you're not going to drop it on your face and kill yourself. And try it. What most people will find is most people think they should just keep pushing up.
Right.
But if they push up and back and they let it float back, those elbows will lock out and they'll lock out more weight.
Float back is the key. Because if you think push it back, they often can't. But if you think float back, somehow they can.
Yep.
So what I've been doing for people that come to me for a first session, we'll work up to what they think is going to be their 3x5, right? And we'll do one set there. And I'm giving them this talk about this the whole time. We're talking about the shoulder flexors. We're talking about all this stuff. And then I'll put more weight on it and they'll do their next set. And it's really tough.
Yeah.
And they're like, we're going to do 5 more. And they're like, uh-uh.
Yep.
I'm like, oh, yeah, no, because you're going
to learn how to get back.
You're going to float it back. And I'm like, don't panic. I'm right here. Do not panic. Be patient with it. Float it back. I swear to you, it'll lock out. And they do it and they can't believe it.
Yep. Yeah, there's a video. If you go to Michael Wolf, you know, very well-known coach from...
Hey, Wolf.
He has a video on his Instagram probably about, gosh, he was probably at my house 8 months ago or so, somewhere in there. And we did this very thing. And he had a new max attempt. I think he was benching 450 or 440 or somewhere in that ballpark, mid-400s. And he missed the first rep. We got on a video, got a great video of him missing the first rep, and he pushes it straight up.
Right.
And I said, look, man, I'm standing right here. I'm not going to let you drop it on your face. When it starts to grind, get it back. Keep floating it back over your throat, over your chin, over your mouth. And so we waited 7-8 minutes, and he did it again, and he locked it out. And we got a great video, so you can actually see the before and after. If you go back to Wolf's Instagram, what is he at? Now I'm going to screw this up.
Is that Wolf Strength?
I think it's Wolf Strength. That sounds right.
Yeah, and so if you think about, if you come off your chest and you actually have a vertical bar path off your chest, you're touching below your shoulder joint, you have a vertical bar path off your chest, it's a little bit of a tricep extension.
Oh, it's all triceps.
And you don't get to use your pecs, you don't get, not like you should, and you don't get to use any of those shoulder extensions. Do you think that that's BS?
I think, what's BS?
Do you think you get, I've stared at netters, I've watched hundreds and hundreds of, thousands of bench press reps. I mean, I think that they get that thing, you know, past that hard spot, and then they get to use that shoulder flexor. They get to add a little bit of mass to get that.
No, I think it's both for sure. I think that's the shoulders with the triceps.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you put the triceps in an advantageous position then where it's so much easier to lock it out, right? Again, how much more, if you're going to do a pin press, a pin bench press, and the bar's only going to move 2.5-3 inches, how much more can you do than your regular bench press? Or a four board press. Those of you guys have heard of board presses where you lower it to the board. I mean, your triceps are in this great position there. And if you've got it back where it needs to be, which is the shoulder, that's the front delts, it's the flexor's job to get the bar back over that throat where it needs to be. And then the triceps can take over and just smack, and they just lock out.
Smack.
That's all they do.
Hey, man, I think that we've talked about this one pretty well.
Hey, one other thing I want to talk about. Frequency real fast, just because, so we can mention it. Am I still on?
You're still on, yeah.
I sound funny in my ears. And I do think that the bench press, long term, can be trained with a higher frequency than any other lift.
Yeah.
You know, we start by squatting 3 times a week in linear progression. And one of the first moves we'll make when we have to start trying to elongate linear progression is we usually take that Wednesday squat day and we make it a light day. kind of tends to be normal. And then eventually we'll move to like a 4-day split and we'll drop the light day. And now we're squatting twice a week and deadlifting twice a week and benching twice a week and pressing twice a week.
We're adding
and
half
one of
a
the
session.
First thing I do when that starts to slow down is I add another bench session. And by the way, it could be another press session, but the press beats you up more than the bench press does. Now that's just, again, that's not everybody. And there's always going to be outliers that say that's not me. But what we found in general is that most of our clients, as they become late intermediate and advanced lifters, make the best progress pressing twice a week and benching 3 times a week. And so don't be scared to, and by the way, I've seen people bench 4 times a week and make actually really good progress as well. So don't be scared to crank up the intensity or crank up the frequency on that bench press. It's probably the best way to get volume in on the bench press. So rather than benching 5 sets of something, 6 sets of something, 7 sets of something, 8 sets of something,
add
another session of 3 or 4 sets, and then it gets that same volume. So tends to work really well.
We do that automatically when we move to the 4-day split. We add a half session a week.
That's right, on both bench and press.
And then we add another.
A fifth, correct.
And then we add another.
Yeah, and so if I've got a competitive lifter that's doing a strength lifting meet, by the time the last 8 weeks of the strength lifting meet, going to the strength lifting meet, I'll bench twice and I'll press 3 times. Right now, it won't be a straight press, like maybe it's an actual competitive press and a strict press and a press lockout, you know, something like that. But just something to keep in your back of your mind, where you're like, man, if you are a late intermediate advanced bench presser and it's stalled for a while, one of the first things I would do is I would kick up the frequency on the bench press.
Well, that's the Barbell Logic Podcast. Thanks so much for listening. Go to iTunes, please. We have recently learned, a friend told us, that the rankings on iTunes are largely determined by how many new subscribers you get in a given week, not total downloads. So, hey, tell a friend, get them to subscribe.
Yeah.
Give us a 5-star review if you got time. But boy, those 2 subscribers.
Or like make like 15 or 20 accounts and subscribe on all of them. That's fine too.
That's fine. But thanks for listening. We'll talk to you soon.